Hello everybody and welcome to Dark DJ Productions, and you've probably already seen what I'm doing tonight, so let me just clear my throat and move the camera down. So yeah, we're going to be looking at this. This is the Bossman Games London Midland Scottish Railway Stania Mogul. That's literally what it is. It's just a Stania Mogul. There's no fun name for it like a Black 5 or an 8F, or it's just Stania Mogul. So I'm looking at this because one of my very, very kind Patreon supporters, Nate, decided that if I finished doing my testing on the Armstrong today, and if I could drive it all the way to Minehead on the West Somerset for some odd reason, he would get me the Bossman Games Mogul. So I did that, and he bought that. So I owe him something. I don't know. I know he's in America. I'll have to get him some sort of pint when he comes over here at some point. Anyway, so I'm doing this sort of for him. So I'm going to do an entire proper Dark Tries on it, and I'm going to basically drive it, or not drive it, as I will discuss later, over part of the Western Lines of Scotland. Was going to drive it on the Severn Valley Railway, but I always seem to, like, I've already driven on the Severn Valley Railway recently, and it's a bit short, and I don't know how long I'm going to go on for, because I'm probably going to unmute myself in a recording room in the Discord server, and possibly talk to some people about the Mogul. So, my throat clearing all over. What is a Stania Mogul? Well, it's a Mogul. That's really, there is all there is to it, really. It's Stania's actual first design for the London, Midland and Scottish Railway. I nearly said London North Western Railway then. I don't know why. I must be around Chris too often with his London North Western fetish. I thought I had more wagons down. Oh, they're there. Anyway, so the Stania Mogul, first designed by Sir William Stania for the LMS. He comes from the Great Western Railway, which is quite funny because I've got a funny story to tell you about the Mogul in a minute, and I've got some to show you about it. But basically, they were built from 1933 to 1934. There weren't that many built. They were basically an extension of the existing Hughes Crab, but with modifications by Stania, including, for some reason, these being the only class of Stania locomotive with horizontal cylinders. If you look at all of Stania's other locomotives and rebuilds, especially in his style, they have inclined cylinders slightly for clearance issues. That's why the front end of the Mogul looks quite ungainly, because it's all quite straight, and as you can see here on the cylinders, you can see that because they're straight, it's very much quite squarish at the front here. It didn't help that actually when they were first built and throughout all of their lives, they weren't actually paired with Stania tenders. Now, Bossman Games has obviously included one because the Preserved Mogul has run with a Stania tender in the past. But, as you can see there, and we'll get to deliveries and other bits in a minute, they ran with Fowler tenders. So let's not look at that for a minute, because that is something for in a minute. Now, excuse me for 1 second, I'm going to try and cough so that I don't destroy my voice box while doing this video. Bleh. Bleh. Anyway, enough of me choking. So yeah, not many of these were built. They were the standard engine from Stania until he designed the Black 5, which was based on this, as you can probably clearly see. And they worked right up till the end of the LMS and were passed into British Railways, obviously. And only one member of the class has survived, number 42968, which will be driving for part of this run. So that's the basic history out of the way. Now I want to tell you a funny story. And to do that, I've got to show you some deliveries. So, if I just scooch down here first of all. So the first member of the class was this one, number 13245. Now what is absolutely hilarious is that because Stania came from the Great Western, a lot of people already know this story. The drawing office basically drew up something quite funny to put on top of the cab. They didn't find it funny. They wanted to please Stania because they knew where he'd come from. So the very first of the Moguls came out with, ooh, if I scooch up here, a Great Western style safety valve bonnet. I could not believe it when Bossman Games included that as an option. Because 12345 was actually outshopped with that safety valve bonnet. And Stania was like, lol, nope, get rid of it, get rid of the evidence, destroy it. And they did. So no other Stania Moguls actually ran with them. However, Bossman has included that as a bit of a funny, and I basically think it's essentially, if we paired this with a Great Western tender of some sort and gave it a Great Western green livery, it would essentially be a case of What if, I think it's, yeah, what if Stanier had succeeded Collett in the 1930s, and what would he have designed? It might have been like that. So I find that hilarious, and that's a fun story for anybody who's looking at the Stanier moguls from an interest point of view. Now, the other thing that Bochmer has included is this, which is the other style of safety valve bonnet, which is basically the safety valve in the dome still, but it just looks a bit different to the normal one, as you can see over there, because the safety valve is still in the centre of the boiler. Eventually, they all ended up with the what you call a domeless type boiler, but it's technically a dome and a top feed. So it's technically a domed boiler with the safety valves, as you can see there, moved over to the top of the firebox on most conventional Stanier locomotives. That's where they are. But a couple of them had this. I don't know if it was just the first one or if a couple had them. But again, it's nice that Bochmer Games has included them as a thing. And yeah, I think that's kind of a nice little feature. It sort of gives you that interest that you could potentially, anyway, run a scenario where you're running 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on his very first test run, and Stanier comes out of his office and starts shouting at everybody, "What is this thing doing on my railway? Why has it got a Great Western safety valve bonnet? Get rid of it immediately!" And then when they outshot 1, 3, 2, 4, 5, they outshot it with that safety valve, and he's like, "That's better, but we can do better than that. Let's go put a normal one on," and they do. So there, that's the funny story about the Stanier mogul. No other Stanier locomotive had a Great Western safety valve bonnet except that one. So that's kind of a fun story. So we've looked at that little bit. Let's have a look at the livery. So you can probably all, you're all probably looking at this red one and thinking, "Oh, that looks very nice." Completely fictional. Midland Railway crimson, they never wore it. They were always painted black, which is, you know, racist. But yeah, they were all painted black, and they all had foul attenders throughout their entire lives because Stanier hadn't had sufficient time to draw up a tender. I never understand that story about, oh, Stanier didn't have time to design his tender. Well, designed an entire engine? Tender? Engine? Tender? Which one takes more time? Anyway, it doesn't matter. The tender didn't really match the loco anyway, but the good thing is, because Bochmer included the Stanier tender, you can probably basically pinch the Stanier tenders from the Jubilee. I think the Jubilees had lined black tenders at one point. Or maybe the 8Fs. We'll have to have a look at that at some point. So you've got the fictional livery here of LMS Crimson. You've then got a couple of variations of the theme, because you've got LMS lined black with the two different numbering schemes. So they started off with the scheme like 1, 3, 2, 4, 5 up to sort of like 1, 3, 2, 8, 7. But they're eventually renumbered into the more familiar 2945 to 2987 series. So you can tell how many were built. So you got line black in with that numbering scheme, and then the later numbering scheme. You've got the same again, but unlined black, as you can see here, with the, you know, the, what do you call it, serif lettering, which, it's still a little bit of a weird alpha shine to these, but they look pretty decent. Next up we have the what is called the M livery. Now, this is supposed to be a transitional British Railways livery, although I can't help noticing that it's meant to have a big cast M in front of the 2947. It was like bolted on, because I'm pretty sure Black Fives had that too. I'm pretty sure that's meant to be there. Not sure why it's not. Don't know whether it's a model problem or whether it's a me problem. I don't know, because it might be that I haven't set it up properly. I'm sure someone in the know will tell me when I bother to have a look at the comment section, which I might do in a minute. But anyway, so you've got the transitional livery with British Railways on the tender, and the simple block numbering there. Now, I'm a bit iffed out by, doesn't seem to be a wartime black version on more or less any of these, which would have been nice to see. It's similar to what's on the Royal Scots, which I technically still haven't done a dark tries on for some reason. I don't seem to, I seem to miss a load of things when I do this. So I seem to sort of skip a lot of products and mainly do Caledonia Works, mainly because that's, you know, I test stuff and I, you know, all that jazz. I'm not going to go into it. It's only when I buy or gift or get gifted something else that I'll try it. Although there is a few things I need to pick up and look at. But you also get British Railways liveries, as you can see over here, just to skip over my rambling. This is actually the preserved version, which we're going to be driving, 42968. But as you can see, it's in line black. You also get early and late crest tenders for it too. So, before I unpause, so we've had a look at the liveries. What do I think of the model overall before I go and have a look at the sounds and stuff? The fact there's a lot of variety with the top feeds and the safety valves and all that, that's a big bonus. But I am going to come back and say about what I said about the Merchant Navies recently, which is that some of the textures do seem to be a little bit blurry, and it kind of reminds me of the older RSC models. Now, I'm quite sure, now someone's probably going to correct me, I'm quite sure, looking at these textures and the way these models are made, that Ben Jervis, I'm sure he used to work for DTG at one point, so it just sort of reminds me of that. I'm not sure whether I'm right or not. I don't really do that much research. I try to, but in the world of development, especially with all the, you know, bad stuff that's happened in the past and the fact that I don't seem to be able to keep my gob shut, overall I'm just a little bit iffy on the textures sometimes, you know, a little bit too shiny and whatnot, but overall it's a decent model. Oh, the only other thing I noticed was sometimes the tendons don't seem to match alpha channel wise with the loco, mainly on the Fowler tenders, but I think that's because somebody else mainly built the Fowler tenders. I think I know who it is, I'm not going to mention their name just in case I'm wrong. But Loco was definitely Boffman. The Fowler tenders, I think, was somebody else, because then the same was featured with the AF and the Jubilee, I think. Other than that, from what I've seen overall around the engine, I must admit, I do quite like it. It's a bit ungainly at the front. It seems to have a lot going on here. Unfortunately, Stanley Moguls aren't really my favourite class of Stanley Loco. Now, if a Princess Royal came out, I'd be slobbering all over that thing. Just depends if it's going to be Boffman or Caledonia Works or Victory Works who make it. Who knows? But as a package, can't really complain. It's got a lot of variety and it adds another loco to, you know, LMS era routes and whatnot. And if you mainly want to drive the preserved version of the Severn Valley Railway, then, you know, that's another reason to just buy the route. So, buy the route, buy the loco. I don't know. Anyway, I am just going to very, very quickly jump in here and see if there's any comments for a moment. People are making food because they're hungry. Someone just pointed out my texture problem might well be to do with Railworks Enhancer, because I suck, basically, and I can't but change both of my settings. So here we are with 4296. Ooh, excuse me. 42968, we've got a passenger train, and we're going to look at the loco now. So, I imagine I've got a bit of lag because there's other locos over there, or because I've got a lot going on my computer at the moment. Let's just close that. And, nope, everything else is fine. So, what is it like? Let's have a look at the cab then. So, this is Stanley's first design, I've mentioned. So, the cab is pretty similar to the rest of it, except for the reverser. That I've noticed a lot more of the pipe work. The reverser looks really odd. I think it might be a hangover from the Horwich mogul, you know, the Hughes mogul. So you got this cab view, you got outside there, you got this side, back here, up here looking at the gauges, a bit further back looking at the entire cab, down into the firebox, which is there. Fire looks pretty good, must admit. So I've been looking at fireboxes recently on locos, and must admit, some of them, yeah. I mean, I'm looking at the one from the N15 the other day, and it looks like a pizza. I was looking at the one with the Midland Spinner from DT, and that looks like roast potatoes. That firebox looked pretty good, and the Caledonia Work one does look good too, although I must say that the fire effect might be worth looking at in the future. So, you know, it's a real shame, actually. The fact that the original Bossman Games loco, the Black 5, had camera views that went all around the loco. Now, because of the feature that is in this loco, which I'll talk about in a minute because it's a new feature, I'm a bit disappointed that we can't actually have camera views outside looking around the whole loco. It could be to do with the way the loco is modelled, but would have been nice. It seems like a step backwards. However, the thing that's been included is a bit of a step forward, so we'll have a look at that in a moment. I think the other thing that I thought was a step back is the fact you can't pull in the wind deflectors here. At least I don't think you can. I've tried, but you can't. But you can still close the windows. So that's a nifty little feature. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the brakes off. And I can show you the cool little feature, which means that I'll be able to go and have a little break while I'm doing this journey today. Now, I might want to talk about it, but The Stadia Mogul comes with Bossman Games' new feature, which is not only have you got an automatic fireman, I know I have to still do injectors and things, but you've also got an automatic driver of sorts. And what that does is that basically sets the engine on what I've called cruise control. Because essentially what it does, it makes the train go forward and it does the reversal and regulator. And basically all it's doing is basically keeping it a consistent speed. Which is fine. It's an interesting feature if you just want to sort of watch a train go by. And, you know, it's a bit like what they used to do in MFTS. Unfortunately, you can't do what you used to do, which is just basically sit in a train and let the train take the train. You still have to drive it in most of Railworks. But this is the first engine I've seen with a proper cruise control implemented. So we're going to have a look at how that works in a few moments. So as I said, we've got 42968. We're going to go to, I think, Castle Douglas, and possibly, if I've got some people around, I might continue onward to Dumfries, and if I'm feeling really adventurous, I might go any further. The only problem is, with the auto driver and fireman, you still have to do the injectors. So, unless Bossman can sort that out one day, that would be a perfect way of just having engines that go around that you can sort of still do the whistles and things on, and other bits and bobs, or sit in the coaches while the train takes the train. Now, the other thing I didn't mention that I haven't actually put down is this has two different types of whistles. You've got a Stanley Hooter and you've got the Fowler whistle that they would have been built with. And I think this one had the Fowler whistle. Yeah. So we're going to be driving this bad boy along from Stranraer. So without much further ado, I suppose I had better set it up to go. So let's put the reverser in forward. And let's activate lazy mode. So if I go to the cab, so I can show you. So if I go back over here. Let's activate the auto fireman. Seat goes up. Firebox starts going off and doing its own thing. Now, if you've got the Stanley Mogul, control what, as long as you've got your engine in whichever gear you want it, so if you've set it to be forward, which I have, press control Y, automatic driver enabled. It will not stop at signals, buffers or stations. So what this basically means is I now have no control over the loco's movement until I turn it back off again. The engine will just keep to the speed limits of the line. So you can't see it right now, but I'm not touching this engine. If I do like a four view, you can see the FM HUD up there. I know it doesn't look like much, but I'm not controlling the engine at the moment. I'm just watching it leave. It's doing its own thing, save, so cylinder valve cocks are open, and they've just closed themselves. I haven't touched it. So it's a nifty little feature if you just sort of want to be able to film a train going along, or I know you can do the same thing with AI, but you can sort of take over if you want. So you can basically let the engine go into autopilot. Now, I've got to say about the sounds, they are basically the same chuff sounds as on the Black 5, but that's not really a bad thing because they're basically the same. So let's have a look at the engine as we go along. And hopefully the frame rates will pick up in a minute. Once we get away from the other ones. See, there you go, the engine just eased off as it hit 20 miles an hour, because if I ping up the HUD there, you can see that it's 15 miles an hour, 20 miles an hour at the moment. As soon as we hit that 45 zone, or the whole train's gone through the 45 zone, the engine will kick up and it will start doing the speed limit there again. So if I just jump back in the cab and jump to the other side, you'll see what I mean if you look at the F5 HUD up there. It's not perfect, but still quite interesting. And again, I'm not touching the controls at all, especially because you guys know me, I drive at an incredibly low cutoff. The auto driver runs at a high cutoff. But I can still whistle and stuff. Not that funky. Let me see if we can turn the sounds up while we do this. Thank you. trying with all his might to get up to the beach. Again, I'm not touching it. I hope we get away from those other moguls soon, because it's really tanking frame rates around here. Same thing happened last time I tried the Bokken Games Loco, actually. That was really weird. Normally it's fine. It does have an interest in maybe Princess Royals at least. I've just seen someone writing that in the chat. I'll just have a look at the chat while the MG drives itself. Someone said basically, oh, third party doing better than the people who made the game. Yes, indeed they do. For the crabs over these, that's fair. I kind of agree in a way. So I'm reading the chat box, so. That's what I was saying about the crabs. Anyway, so now on the mainline bit, we've just hit the 60 limit, and now we're in the 75 bit. So hopefully, the mobile will now try and pick up 75 miles an hour. Without my interference, of course. That's it, basically just cruise control. Which means I can do some shots. Well, not sort of those sort of shots, you know what I mean. Just sort of trackside. Someone's saying that they quite enjoyed the scripting and delivery part of the video. Well, once the video's up and fully finished, you'll be able to have a look at that bit. Don't understand why it's all of a sudden being all skippy, frame ratey, laggy. It wasn't doing this earlier. I think it's probably to do with the computer, I don't know. So apart from the lagging, what do we think of the mogul so far then? blow the same whistles off the old bastard tree. There's a speed limit of 40 coming up, and then going back to 60. So at the moment we failed miserably to pick up to line speed. So the auto driver isn't perfect. It's not instantaneous. By the way, for people saying about Caledonia Works, the website's down at the moment, so it should be back up, I don't know when, but it is being modified at the moment. I'll have to take it over for some point, I think it's up for later. Now you'll see that the engine automatic driver takes over the brakes, easing off and coming into a short section. So it does read the line speed ahead, so it's a bit like an AI loco. I'd love to know how he's done this though, because I'd love to be able to implement this on an engine like me. I mean, it's also an optional feature if you want to drive them over properly. I mean, this feature does actually allow you to take over and be in the fireman if you want, which essentially you're still doing anyway because you're running the injectors. Reserve line cab rides, I'm fond of it. I might start going around a little bit more. Just to do a little bit extra with the mobile, see if it actually behaves a bit better in regards to train rates. And again, if you just sort of want to sit back and enjoy the journey, I don't have to look at the, I don't have to sort of concentrate on the line because I've set all my path up. So I can literally just, if I really wanted to do for this entire stream, which I'm clearly not going to do, I could just sit here all stream. Could be a nice thing to do actually as a, ooh, there's an idea. I could do that as a dark railway thing. I could have this as the loco taking the train. And I could just sit and do like a, you know, passenger ride from one end of the line to the other. That'd be quite nice. But I have got to keep an eye on those injectors. Better most of the time, keeping the injectors all the time, I'd imagine. really lazy way of doing the screen, by the way. It's kind of quite surreal, just sort of sitting in the cab and letting the engine actually do most of the work and not having to concentrate on the brakes or reverser. Doesn't mean you can find it more difficult to do speed runs. And if I wanted to, I could just turn the auto driver off, I would. Kind of relaxing for a change, to be able to do a screen where you just sort of relax a bit. Why are we hitting the speed limit? Since we are approaching Len Lewis and we've got to go into the loop, as you see here. So again, I'm going to ask, how are we enjoying the Stanley Mogul then? And silly question, but who else thinks that maybe putting this cruise control on other trains would be quite nice? I think it's a fun little idea. Not perfect, but now I've actually experienced it, it's not too bad. Doesn't make a good sound. From this angle, you can also see how much narrower the tender is to the cab of the loco, interestingly enough. For you, if you're that way inclined. Or not. Anyway, I'm probably not going to do the full length of this run today because I think that's probably enough for the Dark Tri section. I may well come back with a different video in a little while, I think. Because I'm not really sure what else I can say, really, to be honest. It's a decent enough boat though. A bit heavy on frame on this route for some reason. So what I think I'll do, unfortunately, is I will see, after I do a few more panny shots, how long I've been going with this video, and I might come back with a different one in a little while. Just because I don't think I can really say much else apart from, well, if you like it, go buy it, I suppose. But, yeah, that was the Danny Mogul. I know it's not a very long stream, but it is a live tries of the... So, yeah, not really much else I can say, I'm afraid. Thanks everyone for watching this particular video. I may well come back shortly with another one. Thank you all for watching, and we will see you next time.